Welcome to the DVD Shelf Movie Reviews, where movies are celebrated, not incinerated. Hey guys, David Rose here, your host of the DVD Shelf Movie Reviews. And on this very special occasion, we've returned to the cinematic catacombs I like to call the DVD Vault of Horrors to celebrate the 40th anniversary of one of the most influential horror films ever burned onto celluloid. Back in 1974, terrified audiences everywhere were introduced to a skin-wearing, chainsaw-wielding maniac and his equally deranged family of backwoods cannibals in the seminal genre classic, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Never before did big-screen terror ever feel so real and visceral, and today, 40 years after its initial release, we'll discover why and how this macabre masterpiece still manages to get under your skin. We'll meet the real-life madman who inspired the mayhem, and with the help of various cast and crew interviews, we'll get the full story behind the movie's notoriously hellish film shoot. I'll share my own thoughts and feelings about the film, show off the brand new 40th Anniversary Collector's Edition Blu-ray set, and finally, I'll give it my final recommendation. But that's not all. With the success of the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre came the inevitable film franchise that consists of two direct sequels, a 1994 reimagining, a 2003 remake, a 2006 prequel to the remake, and a 2013 reboot/sequel that completely disregarded the previous sequels and remakes.
So now I've gone cross-eyed.
Yeah, I know, it's a bit confusing, but I'll wade through this messy series and reveal which installments that I think are worth checking out, and which ones deserve to be sent to the chopping block. We've got a lot of ground to cover today. So, without further ado, let's rev up the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Plainfield, Wisconsin was your typical small farming town in the middle of nowhere. And in the eyes of its residents, local handyman Ed Gein was a hard worker and generally friendly guy. But little did they know that behind that mild-mannered demeanor dwelled a vicious monster. Ed was born in 1906 and grew up on an isolated farm in Plainfield with his older brother, his severely alcoholic father, and his religiously fanatical mother. But by 1945, when Ed was 39 years old, they were all dead. During her life, Ed's domineering mother would incessantly quote Old Testament Bible verses while preaching pure hatred, referring to all people, especially women, as evil, dirty, and disgusting creatures. Ed grew up trying endlessly to please her, but never was she fully satisfied, and yet the two formed an abnormally strong bond that didn't end with her death, which was just the beginning of a downward spiral that caused Ed to commit countless acts of unspeakable horror. On the morning of November 16, 1957, local hardware store owner Bernice Warden went missing, and her son soon discovered a large blood stain on the floor of her store. Once the police noticed Ed's name on the store's most recent sales receipt, they rushed out to his farmhouse and found Bernice's decapitated body hanging upside down and gutted like a deer. Officers stumbled across a brown paper bag and pulled out the dismembered face of Mary Hogan, a bartender who had disappeared 3 years prior. Ed had been living in complete squalor, except for the few rooms his mother would frequent during her life, which had been sealed off and kept in pristine condition. After Ed was taken into police custody, he was absolutely, almost disturbingly compliant, and was happy to answer any questions investigators had about his motives and gruesome lifestyle. Ed confessed to digging up the bodies of freshly deceased middle-aged women who perhaps reminded him of his mother and taking them home to use them in hideously thorough ways. He'd construct pieces of furniture and various trinkets out of their bones. He'd stretch their skin into seat covers and lampshades. He'd make bowls out of the tops of their skulls, and even made meals out of their organs. He'd use the skin of these women to stitch together various pieces of clothing like gloves, stockings, corsets, and of course, masks made from their faces. Then after nightfall, he would allegedly head out his front door wearing his ghastly creations and dance in the moonlight. The story of Ed Gein made worldwide headlines and has since become one of the most talked about real-life horror stories in American history. Even as jaded as we are these days by seeing brutal crimes, graphic war imagery, and grisly violence displayed everywhere, the infamous tale of Ed Gein is still as unsettling as ever. But imagine how this shocking news must have resonated with his neighbors, the small-town folk of Plainfield, Wisconsin, way back in 1957. Thank you.
Harlem, and he's a nice man, just like anybody else. The only difference I'd say in the man, he seems to be a little high.
The townspeople of Plainfield may have seen Ed Gein as a bit of an oddball, but never one who was capable of such savagery. Journalists from all over the world swarmed around the humble town, whose residents were never afraid to keep their doors unlocked, until now. The criminal acts of Ed Gein may have terrified the nation, but because they were so grotesque and so over-the-top sadistic, many started to become fascinated by them. And when such a strange, double-edged public response like this occurs, it isn't long before American pop culture takes notice. Horror and crime novelist Robert Bloch was living in Wisconsin during this time, and in 1959, a mere 2 years after Ed Gein's arrest, Bloch was inspired to write what has since become his most famous novel, the aptly titled Psycho, which soon caught the attention of master filmmaker Alfred Hitchcock, who adapted the book into a hit film. Played brilliantly by Anthony Perkins, the film's titular psycho, Norman Bates, was a quiet and even-tempered motel operator who, like Ed Gein, had a disturbingly excessive affinity for his own domineering mother.
Well, a boy's best friend is his mother.
Come to find out that Norman murdered her years ago in a fit of jealousy, and after developing a split personality disorder, he continued his killing spree whenever he'd assume the identity of his dead mother.
It's a much more violent book than it is a movie. You know, the girl gets beheaded in the shower as opposed to simply stabbed to death. But the book is mild by comparison with the facts of Ed Gein. I mean, this was a crazy, sad man, and who became a piece of American mythology, I think. He is the underpinning of Bloch's book, but he obviously is there, dare we say this, in spirit, in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre pictures, and arguably in Silence of the Lambs.
Ed Gein's chilling acts of body mutilation went on to inspire another crazed cinematic slasher, Buffalo Bill, the main antagonist in the 1991 Oscar-winning thriller, The Silence of the Lambs, an adaptation of the second in a series of crime novels written by Thomas Harris that featured notorious cannibalistic serial killer, Dr. Hannibal Lecter, who was played magnificently by Sir Anthony Hopkins here and in several other films. In Silence of the Lambs, Jamie Gumm, who goes by the nickname Buffalo Bill, was portrayed to creepy perfection by character actor Ted Levine, and is a composite of about a half a dozen real-life psychopathic killers, most notably Ed Gein, as he uses the flesh of his female victims to piece together his own full-bodied skin suit. One of the film's producers, Ronald M. Bozeman, was no stranger to skin-wearing psychotics, since almost 20 years prior, he was the production manager on another Ed Gein-inspired horror film that would not only become a revered classic in its own right, but would also go on to literally change the face of the horror genre forever. Psycho was an important step in the horror genre because it made the danger feel a little too close to home, much like the story of Ed Gein. Robert Bloch's novel, and Alfred Hitchcock's subsequent film adaptation, ushered in the 1960s in a big way, and with the dawn of the new decade came a fresh wave of horror films that depicted more realistic threats during a time where the genre was dominated by radioactive mutants, aliens from outer space, and fantastical gothic monstrosities.
Most horror films before then, not all, but most, were gothic romances. Take the Hammer films in the 56, 57. They were all in castles with Dracula and Frankenstein and barons and the European aristocracy. Psycho was a whole different breed of movie. In a way, it prefigured what was going to happen in the culture.
Once the 70s rolled around, the hopefulness and optimism of the 60s collapsed into cynicism and paranoia as the seemingly unwinnable Vietnam War raged on overseas and our president had turned his back on the promise of getting us out of there. The assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. heightened a racial unrest that hadn't really stopped since the civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s. The hippie generation was growing up, but continued to rebel against their parents' traditional family values. And whether it was the politically driven shootings that took place at Ohio's Kent State University or the multiple murders committed by a cult guided by the psychotic Charles Manson, television was allowing the country to absorb every dark and frightening detail. Best-selling books were prophesying the apocalypse and sensationalizing the inevitable fall of human society, and these themes were reflected in science fiction films like Planet of the Apes, Soylent Green, and Logan's Run, or in supernatural thrillers like The Exorcist, The Omen, and Rosemary's Baby. Leave it to a good scary movie to exploit our greatest fears and anxieties. In 1968, low-budget filmmaker George A. Romero created one of the most groundbreaking horror movies to ever lumber onto the silver screen. A deliberate political statement on late 60s culture, Night of the Living Dead took all the violence and bloodshed that Americans were now used to seeing on the nightly news and kicked it up a few notches.
We were also, you know, very aware of the time and the, you know, the sort of anger of the 60s. You know, I think mostly that the 60s didn't work. You know, we thought we had changed the world or sort of, we're part of some sort of a reform that was going to make things better. And all of a sudden, it wasn't any better. It wasn't any different. So, you know, I think there was a bit of rage, a bit of disappointment. So I invented these characters, which in my mind, they were just ghouls. The dead are coming back to life. That's the revolution. That's the big thing that everybody is missing. And we just wanted to be, you know, make as ballsy a horror film as we could make.
Night of the Living Dead continued a trend made popular by Psycho, where the true horror wasn't from outer space or some distant fantasy land. It was right out your front door. Filmed in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the independent shocker quickly became popular when it played at grindhouses and drive-in theaters, the same types of venues that had created a boom where filmmaking wasn't limited to the prestigious Hollywood studios anymore. Anybody with a camera could make a movie anywhere and gain an audience.
Back in the early 70s, big change was happening in the movie business. There had been success with the documentary forms and with handheld cameras, and there was a sense of anything was possible. You know, just grab your camera, grab your equipment, get in the back of the station wagon, go shoot it. You can compete with the big guys.
Years before director Wes Craven brought our worst dreams to life in A Nightmare on Elm Street, and nearly a decade before director Sean S. Cunningham first whisked us away to the blood-soaked Camp Crystal Lake in Friday the 13th, the two horror icons collaborated on 1972's The Last House on the Left, a micro-budgeted revenge flick that captured relentless violence and deviant behavior in a raw documentary style. The danger was as real and terrifying as ever, as two innocent teenage girls are kidnapped, slowly tortured, and brutally murdered by a depraved band of escaped convicts.
I think it's crazy.
What's crazy?
All that blood and violence. I thought you were supposed to be the love generation.
The hippie generation gets literally slaughtered right on screen, yet your expectations are completely subverted when one of the victim's parents successfully take their bloody revenge on the criminals. Barbaric acts of violence may have ripped apart the average American family, but this time, it wasn't afraid to fight back. Interestingly enough, the intense climax of The Last House on the Left involved the wielding of a deadly roaring chainsaw, which, unknowingly at the time, made it the perfect precursor of what was about to come. After graduating from the film program at the University of Texas, up-and-coming director Tobe Hooper had aspirations of becoming a Hollywood filmmaker. But when his early documentaries and art house feature film work garnered little attention, the hungry filmmaker realized he needed to do something more commercial that would grab the audience's attention right out of the gate. So he and his college friend Kim Henkel co-wrote a script for a low-budget horror film that would be so shocking, Hollywood just couldn't look away. What began as a Hansel and Gretel type idea about kids getting lost in the woods quickly turned into a veritable breeding ground of ideas that began as scary stories Hooper vividly remembers his Wisconsin relative telling him when he was younger.
They always had this story, you know, because they could see that it wound me up and it started scaring the hell out of me. And so they would tell this story about the guy that makes the cupboard his furniture with skin, with human skin, lampshades. It stuck with me. It was always ever present.
It wasn't until later that Tobe Hooper realized that these stories were about the grisly true crimes of Ed Gein. But nevertheless, Hooper and Kim Henkel wrote a screenplay that oozed with down and dirty real-world horror, which made it all the more unnerving.
It's like Mothra didn't scare me. Godzilla didn't scare me. It's people that I'm afraid of.
A native of Austin, Texas, it always made Hooper a bit uncomfortable to travel outside the city limits and into the quiet little isolated pockets of rural Texas that sat just beyond the edges of human civilization.
You know, we're all afraid that out there in those kind of dark corners of rural
America or wherever it may be, that there are these inbred types that are doing terrible and dastardly things.
Not knowing what to call their movie, a couple working titles were shuffled around during production until the brilliant decision was made to give it a name that was as bold and in-your-face as the film itself.
Once a friend of mine, and I threw the title out. So I would never see that. I will not, my girlfriend won't see it. I will not see this, nothing by that name. And I said, that's it. That's the title.
The Texas Chainsaw Massacre was like something ripped right off the front page headline of your typical newspaper. And because the film's movie poster would later famously say that it was based on true events, many were misled into believing that what had happened in the film was real, which only heightened intrigue and added to the dread.
The film which you are about to see is an account of the tragedy which befell a group of five youths, in particular, Sally Hardesty and her invalid brother, Franklin.
Narrated by actor John Larroquette, who'd go on to star in the popular 80s sitcom Night Court, this opening crawl made the audience feel like they were watching an actual documentary, which was a device seen earlier in the first minutes of The Last House on the Left and has been imitated by countless movies ever since.
The events of that day were to lead to the discovery of one of the most bizarre crimes in the annals of American history, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Tobe Hooper turned to the drama department at the University of Texas to find five actors who could play a doomed clan of young hippies.
I heard about Tobe Hooper, this wacky guy who had made a movie called Eggshells, was getting ready to make this horror movie. And they were looking for, you know, young people to walk in and get their brains smashed in. I said, I can do that.
Cast in the lead role of Sally Hardesty, Marilyn Burns would go on to gain notoriety as one of the horror genre's original scream queens, who pioneered the strong female survivor trope that would be seen in later slasher films like Halloween, Friday the 13th, and A Nightmare on Elm Street. In playing the role of Sally's irritating, handicapped brother Franklin, Paul Partain made the conscious decision to stay in character throughout the entire shoot, which caused a rift between him and the other actors at the time.
Unfortunately, Franklin was such a whiny bastard that I was afraid if I ever took him off, that I couldn't get him back. And so I kept him on. And so it was easy for me to go, God, I don't want to be near that son of a bitch. And you can't blame him either. It was very easy to imagine that, okay, this is the kind of treatment that Franklin would get and the kind of treatment Franklin would deserve because, you know, he's just who wants to be around that shit all day?
Come on, Franklin. It's going to be a fun trip.
He really was Franklin because Paul Partain is really a nice guy. The guy I met named Franklin was easy to act with because you really didn't have to do much acting.
Give me that flashlight!
No, I got to take the flashlight! All right,
I'm gonna go look for him! Give me that flashlight!
I'll go with you, all right?
Because handicapped characters tend to be portrayed more sympathetically in movies and TV shows, it's a pretty interesting choice to have the guy in the wheelchair be the most annoying of the pack, and Paul Partain's appropriately overdone acting style really makes Franklin great on you. With William Vale and Terry McMinn as young lovers Kirk and Pam, and Alan Danziger playing Jerry, this group was heading out to investigate the gravesite of Sally and Franklin's grandfather following a rash of cemetery vandalisms. But what they didn't know was that they were about to become the guests of honor at one of the most horrific dinner parties in cinema history.
I've seen more dysfunction and more hell in a riddle through families than I would like to have. I wish I hadn't seen that much weirdness and family behavior. So I kind of always wanted to do something, you know, that's about a dysfunctional family.
So what did I want to achieve with the Chainsaw Family? Just scare the shit out of somebody.
Years before Freddy, Jason, and Michael Myers became unstoppable forces of nature, a troop of five innocent college kids were terrorized by a crazed, southern-fried, dysfunctional family with no true motives for their carnage, just an animalistic taste for human flesh. The nightmare begins when the travelers pick up a greasy, gangly hitchhiker with a large facial birthmark and a penchant for self-mutilation. His family used to work at the old slaughterhouse before it was shut down, and he explains the process of killing the cows in explicit detail. But it wasn't long before he randomly decides to attack Franklin with his straight razor, which gets him instantly thrown out of the van. Actor and comedian Edwin Neal was a University of Texas drama student who auditioned for the role of the kooky hitchhiker.
So we ran in there, and here's Tobe Hooper, and Tobe walked over, and he goes, "Come here." And I go, "Hi." And he goes, "Are you mocking me?" And I went, "No, why?" And he goes, "Can you be weird?" And I said, "Whoa, weird is what I do."
I was at the slaughterhouse.
I got an uncle that works at a slaughterhouse.
Hey, my brother worked there. My grandfather, too.
My family's always been in me.
My whole family are Draculas.
Neal modeled the character after his paranoid schizophrenic nephew and turned in a performance so odd that his unpredictable behavior is almost nerve-wracking to watch. Local Shakespearean-trained theater actor Jim Seidel played the owner of the Last Chance gas station and roadside barbecue pit, simply referred to as the Cook. This character originally comes off as friendly and helpful, but we later meet the monster underneath and learn just why he's called the Cook. Seidel plays the Cook as a man with the dueling personalities of a polite southern gentleman and a bloodthirsty, malevolent fiend.
Hey, you be a good. She's a nice girl. You that quick. Get upstairs and get your grandpa.
Actor John Dugan, who at the time was the brother-in-law of co-writer Kim Hankel, was asked to fill a rather strange role. Despite being in his late teens, Dugan was cast as the family's ancient grandpa, and his slight build played perfectly to the character's frail look.
I was doing a play in Chicago and entertaining children, and then Kim called and said, "Hey man, are you crazy?" I said, "Of course I'm crazy, you know me." He goes, "I got something I want you to do." So I put in my notice of the play and went to Texas. So I spent the first half of the summer dancing around in tights, entertaining children. Then the second half of the summer, I was hitting a chick over the head with a sledgehammer.
To turn the young actor into this ridiculously old, living corpse of a human being, a thick layer of prosthetic makeup was designed and applied, not by some professional effects artist, but by a local plastic surgeon, Dr. W.E. Barnes.
When the movie came around, Marilyn was a friend, and she just mentioned to me one day that she was doing this movie, and they needed somebody to do special effects makeup. And I said, "Well, I can do that. I don't know if I can do it or not, except I figured, you know, I've been interested in this sort of thing." And so I bought some books on the subject and just started playing around with it.
I like Grandpa's makeup quite a bit, even though it isn't really the most convincing old man look, but that's kind of what's creepy about it. It's as if Grandpa's wearing a mask made out of his own pasty gray skin, making it look like he's been dead for quite a while. And as bizarre as it was, the idea is that Grandpa is so old and decrepit, he had essentially reverted back to infancy.
He's an embryonic old man. He is so old, he's become childlike again. And that was the basic direction I got from Kim and Tobe. But I can recall Kim, he said, "Have you ever seen a newborn baby? Have you ever seen a baby nurse?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "You know how they kind of get into, you know, they get their hands working and their feet kind of kick." And I said, "Yeah." He goes, "That's what I want for you."
Standing at an imposing 6'4 and 300 pounds, Icelandic-born Gunnar Hansen famously portrayed Leatherface, the brutish family butcher, and one of horror's most recognizable faces, of which he's worn many.
When I signed the contract, Tobe told me that he'd actually decided he wanted me when I came in the door because I'd filled the door.
The character that best embodies Ed Gein's influence on the film, Leatherface hunts and slaughters people like animals, and his frightful appearance stems from the various masks he makes from his victims' faces. Behind the scenes, the other actors kept their distance from Gunnar Hansen in order to make their fear of him feel more authentic on camera, which clearly worked, maybe a little too well. But in actuality, Hansen is anything but scary. And in order to get fully immersed into the mind and mannerisms of a mentally damaged man-child like Leatherface, he did some rather unconventional prep work.
In preparing for the part, I went to the Austin State School, which is a home, large campus for retarded persons. And I spent several days walking around the campus pretending I was a student there, or an inmate, and I didn't think there was really anything else I could do because I obviously the character really doesn't have many lines and is there really only as a physical presence. I thought that was really the only way I was going to be able to define the character anyway. So I spent enough time there to try to learn how to walk a certain way that I felt in some way presented the sort of mental state of this guy.
There have been 7 movies in the Texas Chainsaw franchise, but Hansen has only played Leatherface in this first film, and by all accounts, his performance is by far the most interesting to watch and study.
Leatherface isn't an evil figure. He's a tragic figure. And he's having a bad day as well. I mean, where do these people keep coming from? I mean, they keep showing up at the door. And he's terrified.
Only in this original film do Leatherface's masks truly look like real dried-up sheets of dead human skin. Even with the film's low budget, art director Robert A. Burns' original masks hold up so much better than in any of the other films, where they all look like pieces of rubber that were over-designed by Hollywood makeup artists, not crudely constructed by a crazed killing machine.
I worked a long time doing experimentations of material to try to make something that might look like human skin that was peeled off and dried. And like the Leatherface faces, we took molds of people's faces and I came up with using liquid latex and some fiberglass insulation material that I could peel off in very, very thin sheets and stick in there and so it layered up and it would naturally turn this kind of brownish, yellowish color. It would maintain a bit of the facial form and sewed on things, you know, to make it look like they had peeled somebody's face that they had killed. And then, you know, had the face, had the mouth kind of wired open with wire inside it and wired everything. You could see what they did.
You've heard the expression, you are what you eat. Well, Leatherface is what he wears, you know. He assumes the personality and the character of the mask he dons.
As the film progresses, Leatherface takes on several different personalities depending on whose face he's wearing, be it a man or a woman. There's the predatory hunter-gatherer-butcher, the submissive housewife, and to clean up for dinner, he puts on his best 3-piece suit and a pretty girl's face complete with makeup.
By the time you got, you know, pounds and a half of sweat in your eyes and your mouth and your nose and your clothes were all sweating. They hadn't been washed in 6 weeks. It got easier and easier and easier as we took all the environmental aspects of the family to become the family.
Having a dirty old house full of murderous men calling themselves a family is reaching Charles Manson levels of disturbing. But Leatherface, the cook, and the hitchhiker are actually all brothers. And yet the cook feels like the patriarch, the hitchhiker acts like the bratty son, the grandpa is practically a baby, and when Leatherface is wearing the right face, well, let's just say he's the woman of the house. But of course, let's not forget grandma, or at least what's left of her. Now when you start to break it down like that, it's almost as funny as it is creepy. Call it a perverted, distorted reflection of the typical American family. In fact, Tobe Hooper always looked at the film as a dark comedy first and was disappointed that it took years for audiences to notice, and that's probably because they were too busy being scared out of their wits. But as scary as the film is to watch, the cast and crew would likely tell you that it was even scarier to make. With such a low budget and a relatively inexperienced cast and crew, many of the hardships and genuine moments of panic felt behind the camera managed to seep their way into the finished film, which is a big reason why it continues to be such a real and visceral watch after 40 years.
When I'm running through the woods and Leatherface does this little skip in the woods, the reason for that is that I was just getting ready to turn, the trail that I was running on turned sharply there. And when I turned, my feet went out from under me, and I landed on my back, and the chainsaw went up in the air. So I rolled over and covered my head and waited for it to land. The only way I was going to make that turn without falling down was to do that little turn and sort of Keystone Cop sort of skid to make the turn and go around.
Shot on location in Texas during the particularly hot summer of 1973, you can almost feel the sweltering heat radiate off the film. Fresh out of college, this was the first feature film for 23-year-old cinematographer Daniel Pearl, whose impressive photography is kept simple and naturalistic. And because the tight budget forced him to use grainy 16mm film stock, the movie feels like a raw documentary without having to resort to the usual stunts we've come to expect out of fake documentaries or found footage films, like talking head interviews or visible cameramen. J. Larry Carroll and Sally Richardson's frenetic editing starts out fairly traditional and unobtrusive, but as the madness swells, the cuts and camera work become quicker, tighter, and appropriately messier. Accentuating the on-screen hysteria was the ghoulish experimental soundtrack that was produced by sound designer Wayne Bell with help from Tobe Hooper.
I'd been working with experimental music for some time, and Wayne was into sound. Cut the film in my living room. And right next to it was a little room, a little bedroom, where I had the musical instruments, and so I scored in one room and cut in the other.
The grinding, the droning, the sawing, and the screeching benefits the film's grim atmosphere so much more than any conventional orchestral score would have. The abrasive industrial noise and ghastly imagery harmoniously work together to drive you a little insane by the time the movie ends. Art director Robert Burns had a field day designing the sets and gathering the props to create a veritable psycho's paradise. The budget surely didn't allow for the construction of fake bones, teeth, and roadkill, so he had to go out and hunt for the real stuff.
He was having trouble finding some more exotic bones. At the time, I was working part-time for a veterinarian, so I had access to a huge boneyard, and Bob just took his knapsack, and it was hilarious watching him just jumping over all these things, jumping for joy, and just loading up his knapsack like a complete insane person.
Robert Burns just would get up in the morning and drive around the hills country with a box looking for stuff. He'd find dead armadillos, and he'd find dead chickens, and he'd find cow bones, and he'd find bones he didn't even know what they were. And I know for a fact, as an actor, that a third of my performance came from that set. It pulled it right out of it.
One of the single most defining aspects of the film is Burns' morbidly gritty set decoration, because, just like with his gnarly Leatherface mask designs, these twisted creations all feel woven together by honest-to-goodness maniacs. Ed Gein would have felt right at home. From the wide variety of skulls and teeth, to the bone-covered furniture, to the swing made out of railroad ties, to the famous armchair, to this batshit crazy chicken statue, Burns conceived an entire collection of authentically sick works of art that are so intricately detailed you notice something new every time you watch the film. It's all just too well done to not find some kind of dark and haunting beauty in it. Most of the filming took place in Round Rock, Texas, at a late 19th century built farmhouse that doubled as the demented family's house of horrors. The crew rented it from the owners, gutted it, and turned it into the warped monstrosity where a lot of heinous stuff happens. But what I find fascinating is how little blood and gore you actually see, even during the movie's more shocking moments. With its graphically violent reputation and a head-turning title like the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you expect to see limbs flying all over the place, but the limited budget allowed for very minimal effects work, and I think the film is so much more powerful because of that.
I have won bet after bet after bet of people who have seen the film once, maybe twice, betting me that you see the hook go through the girl. You do not see the hook go through the girl. But they will, of course you do. The hook goes right through. It was a great shot. You see her setting, him setting her down on the hook. But what your mind does is finish the image.
I put in a lot of telephone calls to the MPAA asking their advice. You know, how do I get a PG rating and hang someone on a meat hook?
Ultimately, the film was slapped with an R rating despite its lack of on-camera violence, but what the basic camera tricks and homemade special effects were merely implying wound up being even more disturbing.
A blow to the skull with a heavy hammer would send bone fragments first down into the brain, which would cause involuntary spasms.
I think what makes it so scary is what you didn't see.
And it's also that roaring of the chainsaw that drives you crazy. And that crazy girl that doesn't shut up in the background, which was me.
After her brother and her friends fall victim to the maniacal family, Sally is now helplessly running from Leatherface and his screaming chainsaw. She stumbles back to the gas station and is relieved to see the nice man who helped them out before. Sally thought her nightmare was over, but unfortunately for her, it had only just begun. One of the lasting aspects of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre is how it did so much with so little. But it's the film's infamous dinner scene that truly makes you feel like you've entered hell. After Sally gets abducted by the family, they tie her to a chair and proceed to poke and examine her like a cow in a slaughterhouse. They bring in the sluggish grandpa who takes a little nourishing taste of her blood and tries multiple times to hit her on the head with a hammer. It's a slow burn scene that simultaneously makes your flesh crawl and gives you a slight chuckle because of the insanity of it all. If this were a movie made today, the filmmakers would have likely gone overboard with the blood, the pain, and the torture, but instead they opt for creative camera angles and uncomfortable close-ups. Sally's humiliation and utter panic is what's relatable, and because of the film's nihilistic quality, you could be watching this for the first time and not know what could happen to her, and that anxiety is what makes the sequence still so genuinely frightening. Luckily for Sally, she's able to wriggle out of their grasp and finally escape, but not without one last attempt by the brothers to drag her back into the house. A blood-soaked Sally then hitches a ride on the back of a pickup and laughs hysterically as Leatherface fails to catch up and closes out the film with his iconic chainsaw dance of frustration. While this could be seen as a somewhat happy ending for Sally, the manic look on her face is a clear indicator that this one traumatic night will psychologically damage her for the rest of her life. It's the feel-good movie of the year. As time was running out on the arduous 32-day production, the dreaded dinner scene had not yet been filmed, and already the cast and crew were visibly going nuts. While the whole shoot had its share of problems, the actors can still talk about the excruciating dinner scene as if it just happened yesterday.
One shot where I'm in the chair with the arms, they needed a gag, and they said, somebody get a rag or something. So somebody found something on the floor somewhere and got this gross, filthy rag that had been gosh knows where. And that looks good. Oh, put it in her mouth. This is a gritty, nasty, disgusting that we're going to have to use again and again. No one thought about getting a clean one.
Oh, poor Marilyn. Yeah. You know, we put her through just so much shit. You know, she really, to me, Marilyn Burns. Ooh. She went through hell. She is the original scream queen because she screamed and never let up. She was put through the mill, and I have so much respect for what she went through. Just the days that I worked with her, for like 2 or 3 days that I worked with her.
We shot forever. We shot forever. We shot for like a couple of days or something. It was like insane. It was like, oh. But that was the most, that was, you know, I moved troops in Vietnam easier than that scene, I'm telling you, you know, through triple canopy jungle was easier than that scene.
There were actually two reasons it had to be completed in one night.
They were losing me that day. I was through and had to go. I just had a weak contract with them.
And the other reason is we'd run out of appliances for old grandpa.
I'd been in a makeup chair for probably 6 hours. You know, we probably had 8,000 watts of light blasting on us. Windows are all shut. Blacked out with black cloth, no ventilation. You know, between setups, they'd bring out like a box fan, sit on the floor. But of course, I had 5 pounds of liquid latex on me, so I couldn't feel the breeze at all anyway, you know.
Boy, was it hot, and the meat got rotten in a hurry, and we're all in there. I never did get ill physically, where a lot of people did. They'd run outside, come back in.
You know, it had to be 115 degrees in that room or hotter. And the food was rotting fast. We had to keep changing the head cheese because it would start to turn right away. I mean, you know, an hour into the shooting and it was smelling so bad we had to switch it out. And I think it was very easy for the scene to be very intense because we were all overheated and we all smelled bad and, you know, and the food smelled awful. And probably nobody liked each other at that point anymore, you know. So it was easy to squabble and fight. And
you don't like it, ain't that right? You're just a cook. Shut your mouth.
He had a piece of sausage, a real piece of sausage.
In A-movies, you don't use real sausage. That sausage started decomposing on that plate. If you look closely and watch the film closely, you can see fumes coming up, literally. Now, the plates of sausage are right underneath our noses. And we're all like, leaning, like, quit leaning. Stop leaning. Get back in frame. You know, we're all like, dude, put your nose over here, man.
The Texas Chainsaw Massacre continued to face problems even after filming was finished in the summer of 1973. It took nearly an entire year for the film to push through certain budgetary woes during post-production. As the film was being edited, the initial budget dried up, and director Tobe Hooper and writer Kim Henkel were backed into a corner.
Tobe and I had to sell off basically our portion, a good chunk of our portion of the film, in order to raise more money.
Tobe Hooper then tried shopping his finished film around, but he couldn't find a studio interested in distributing it.
Showed it around, and then this group, this new group, Bryanston Films, showed it to them. They said, you know, instantly, said, you know, we'll buy it on the spot.
We got this letter that said, hey, we made a deal with Bryanston. Hubba, 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 we're going to, you know, this is going to come out. I said, oh, great. And Steve came in the office that day, and I said, look, we made a deal with Bryanston. And Steve said, they're mafia.
Bryanston Pictures was an independent film distributor out of New York City that made its big money on low-budget and adult films, and was apparently run by a pair of notorious brothers with mob connections. Bryanston did start releasing the Texas Chainsaw Massacre in October of 1974, and through word of mouth and a clever marketing campaign, the film was seeing success. But due to Bryanston's shady mob dealings, the cast and crew were not getting fully compensated.
9 months after the film was released, when we were expecting to see a lot of money because the movie was doing so well, my first royalty check was for $47.07. You know, I was on my own. I didn't have a lot of financial commitments, so I wasn't in debt. But I know some of the other guys really struggled because they had bills, they had families, and they knew the movie was making a lot of money, and they had counted on that money.
Basically, they made a deal with a known mafia company, and they couldn't figure out why they got ripped off and said, think about it. Made a deal with a guy named Butchie Perino. What do you think?
Nevertheless, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre would go on to be warmly welcomed by the horror movie-going public, virtually shunned by the mainstream, and even banned in multiple countries because of its erroneously perceived levels of visible brutality. But thankfully, it has since gained the worldwide appreciation and intellectual historical analysis it rightfully deserves.
It really bothers me when they start saying things like, this movie is about Vietnam. This movie is about the degeneration of the American family. No, as Tobe Hooper said, this movie is about meat. As Freud said, sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. And I think that about the original Chainsaw movie. It's a great horror movie. It is not necessarily a comment on American society.
Okay, so maybe there's such a thing as overanalyzing this film. But whether it was intentional or not, it tapped into something primal that makes you want to project something deeper onto it.
The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. After you stop screaming, you'll start talking about it.
Generating conversation is what a well-done piece of art does, and it can't be denied that after 40 years, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre is a true work of art and a landmark horror film that has left an indelible mark on the history of the genre. So let's take a quick look at this special 40th Anniversary Collector's Edition Blu-ray set and see what all it has to offer. First off, I am in love with this illustrated cover art that features Leatherface standing at the threshold of his slaughterhouse door. And what's cool about the package design is that you can choose to have the door open or flip the cover over and have it closed. But seriously, who would want it closed? Open up the inside flaps to a tidy display of four separate discs. But don't be mistaken. Only two of the discs are Blu-rays, and the other two are standard DVDs that contain the same material. The first Blu-ray disc presents the film in stunning video and audio quality that's a significant upgrade from the previously released Ultimate Edition, and beautifully retains the natural warmth and graininess of the original 16mm photography. Supervised by director Tobe Hooper, Dark Sky Films pulled out all the stops with their completely remastered 4K digital transfer and a new 7.1 surround sound audio mix. Disc 1 also contains a whopping 4 feature-length audio commentaries, 2 of them new and 2 from previous releases. Disc 2 features a bevy of brand new features on top of all the bonus content from the original Blu-ray. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Shocking Truth is a standout 75-minute documentary that thoroughly covers the film's production and cultural impact, while Flesh Wounds, Seven Stories of the Saw is a wonderful companion piece that's nearly the same length and comes loaded with anecdotes from several original cast and crew members. Other singular interview featurettes include extensive chats with actors John Dugan and Terry McMinn, production manager Ron Bozeman, and editor J. Larry Carroll. Next up, actor Gunnar Hansen guides us on an insightful tour of the family's farmhouse. The featurette begins in 1993, when the dilapidated homestead was still barely standing in Round Rock, Texas. Then it jumps to the year 2000 after it was disassembled and moved over 60 miles west to Kingsland, Texas, where it has since been the site of several restaurant businesses. More filming locations are revisited in an episode of the ongoing series Horror's Hallowed Grounds, which is also featured in this set. There's also a blooper reel, two sets of deleted scenes, outtakes from the Shocking Truth documentary, various still galleries, trailers, TV ads, and radio spots. Now that is one jam-packed set. When Tobe Hooper and Kim Henkel set out to make this macabre masterpiece in the blistering hot summer of 1973, I'm sure they had no idea what they were getting themselves into. And with the stories we've been hearing from the cast and crew who seemingly went to hell and back making this film, it's a true testament to Tobe Hooper's solid vision and obvious artistic talent that this movie came out as good as it did. The original Texas Chainsaw Massacre looks, sounds, feels, and even smells of pure horror, and with this fully immersive Blu-ray set, you can relive the terror over and over again while marveling at every grisly detail with the greatest picture and sound quality this film has ever been presented in. I proudly give this 40th anniversary collector's edition of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre a hefty 5 out of 5 discs recommendation. This is a must-own movie.
It's really good. You like it?
Oh, yeah, sure. I like it. It's good.
Also available on DVD for any Texas Chainsaw completists out there is the 1988 documentary The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, A Family Portrait Revisited, which features a set of retrospective interviews with actors Gunnar Hansen, Edwin Neal, Jim Sydow, and John Dugan. In all honesty, it's a rather dry presentation that could have used some tighter editing, but it's the stories that make it worth a look for any die-hard Texas Chainsaw fan. Throughout the rest of the 70s and into the 80s, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre quickly went from drive-in staple to modern classic, and its chaotic influence was felt all over the place. The horror genre had changed drastically as minimalistic scares of the 70s gave way to 80s-era splatterfests, thanks to the pioneering artistry of makeup effects wizards like Tom Savini and Rick Baker. Meanwhile, Tobe Hooper went on to direct cult horror films like Eaten Alive and The Funhouse, the Stephen King adaptation Salem's Lot, and the Steven Spielberg-produced thriller Poltergeist. Hooper then went on to sign a 3-picture deal with the notoriously nutty B-movie production company Cannon Films. The first two films, Life Force and Invaders from Mars, failed miserably at the box office, which forced Hooper to return to familiar territory for his third contracted movie at Cannon, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2. Loosely continuing the story from the first film, the family has been in hiding since the original massacre, living under an abandoned theme park among a twisted labyrinth of bones, tubing, and Christmas lights. Carolyn Williams plays Stretch, a local radio DJ who's being harassed over the phone by two obnoxious teenagers during her radio show. Suddenly, the two teens are brutally murdered by Leatherface's family while still on the air, and Stretch now has recorded audio evidence of the slaughter. She shows it to Texas law enforcer Lieutenant Lefty Enright, the uncle of Sally and Franklin Hardesty, who has spent years obsessively investigating the unsolved crimes committed by Leatherface and his family. And he's played by Dennis Hopper in full-on lunatic mode. After Stretch makes the audio evidence public, she's eventually confronted by the family and held captive in their subterranean home, as Lefty dons an entire arsenal of chainsaws to rescue her and serve up some good old-fashioned Texas-style justice.
I'm the Lord of the Harvest.
Who's that? Some new health food bunch?
Now, as you can probably already tell, this film is nothing like the first one. The original is grim, while this is a fiercely unapologetic black comedy. And to give you an idea of the film's goofier sense of humor, we finally learn that the family's name is Sawyer. Because of course, you can't spell Sawyer without Saw.
The Saw is family.
The only returning cast member from the original, Jim Sydow, reprises his role as the cook, whose name is revealed to be Drayton Sawyer, and is first seen winning the grand prize at a chili cook-off competition. The characters of Leatherface and Grandpa also return, but are played by different actors. And even though the hitchhiker didn't quite make it through the first film, his rotting corpse still lives with the Sawyers. Carolyn Williams does such a great job in the demanding lead role of Stretch, considering how she had to fully embrace the absurdity of this film and practically carry it on her shoulders. And it's cool to see that after all these years, she still loves being associated with the part. Completely stealing this movie, though, is the dead hitchhiker's maniacal twin brother, Chop Top Sawyer, played by character actor Bill Moseley, who was chosen for the part after Tobe Hooper was given a copy of The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, a short fan-made parody that featured Moseley as the hitchhiker. A die-hard fan of the original film, you can tell that Moseley was having a ball chewing the scenery to pieces as the ghoulish Chop Top.
Hey, lick my plate, you dog dick!
And he even went on to play the similarly sadistic character of Otis B. Driftwood in Rob Zombie's Texas Chainsaw-inspired horror film House of a Thousand Corpses, and its sequel, The Devil's Rejects. The Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 is a wacky movie, and I love it for that. I appreciate Tobe Hooper for not even trying to follow in the footsteps of his untouchable first film, and instead running in a completely different direction with this crazy mixture of campy humor, broad acting, creative production design, and cartoonishly colorful cinematography, all the while retaining some surprisingly creepy moments and a genuine air of menace that's a little reminiscent of the original movie.
Because you didn't want to make a serious film out of this. If you're going to do it again, you have to blow people's minds in another way.
At the time it came out, of course, if you're a fan expecting, Texas Chainsaw Part 2, if you're expecting the same sort of mood and feeling of the first movie, which is really grisly and horror and scary, you know, this one was funny. Chainsaw 2 was, there's a lot of humor in there.
While the first film is lauded for its almost non-existent bloodshed, this sequel packs in hilariously excessive levels of gory effects that were created by makeup artist extraordinaire Tom Savini, whose groundbreaking work was previously seen in classics like Dawn of the Dead and Friday the 13th. Unfortunately, during filming, the owners of Canon Films gave Tobe Hooper the complete runaround by randomly making budget cuts and constantly demanding script rewrites.
And then we had a screening, cast and crew screening. And the audience laughed throughout the film. And at the end of the screening, Tobe comes to me and says, uh-oh. And we go into a meeting with Canon and they say, we want to see the monsters. We want to see the monsters. That's what the audience wants. So take out all this stuff. And they were like stunned that the film was funny, which if you'd read the script, you would know that it was funny intentionally.
This was going to be a magic, wonderful revisitation. The first film, the why behind the first film. A bit of the why behind the first film. And Canon Films didn't want the why. They just wanted the first film over and over again. The film that was written and shot was truly a wonderful satire. It was a wonderful film. And I hope that one day Tobe can put out his own cut of that movie. The biggest thing that I recall is Canon Films just, they were really horrible. They were horrible. They treated Tobe horribly. And they were constantly second-guessing him, looking over his shoulder, pulling money, giving money. They were just really arbitrary about all of their decisions.
As a result of all these creative differences, yes, the film is a bit messy. But for me, parts 1 and 2 are a required double feature. Because, let's face it, as great as the original is, it's a bit of a downer. So I always like to follow it with this entertaining pick-me-up. Let's just put it this way. If part 1 is the main course, then part 2 is dessert. The Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 was released in the summer of 1986 to dismal reviews and a disappointing box office, which isn't surprising considering how much it strayed from the beloved original, but it seems like these days, people are finally getting the joke. By the late 80s, New Line Cinema, the studio that originally brought us Freddy Krueger, sought to revive the Texas Chainsaw franchise by bringing it back to its darker, more sinister roots and turning Leatherface into the next slasher superstar. Low-budget filmmaker Jeff Burr, who had already directed a couple small horror films, got the job.
But I basically was like probably literally the 50th choice to do this movie. I really think they literally went down a list because I've met so many directors in the subsequent years that say, oh yeah, you did that Leatherface movie. Yeah, I was offered that, but man, I just couldn't do it. So I was just literally, I got it by, you know, total default.
Released in early 1990, Leatherface, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 3, touted itself as being a direct continuation of the first two films. But with it came a brand new set of Sawyers and a whole slew of unanswered questions. One of the main heroes was played by former Dawn of the Dead star and horror icon Ken Foray, and Leatherface's deranged brother Tex was played by none other than future Lord of the Rings fixture Viggo Mortensen.
Oh! I like Texas.
Carolyn Williams, Stretch from Part 2, briefly appeared as an unnamed news reporter, with director Jeff Burr basically confirming that it was supposed to be the same character. Now, this movie is certainly not that great, but it honestly isn't really that horrible either. I think the biggest problem with it is that it's just kind of boring, and with this being the third in the series, the idea of a couple of people getting lured into another house full of murderous rednecks was starting to feel a little tiresome. Once Tobe Hooper left the franchise, gone also was his unique sense of family dysfunction and chaos that made his two Texas Chainsaw films so entertaining. But when a major studio like New Line storms in and tries to replicate that madness, it just feels stale. That being said though, one of the best things is the makeup and gore effects that were supervised by Tom Savini protege, Greg Nicotero, who has since become a giant in the industry. The only problem, though, was that in order to avoid the dreaded X rating for the brutal violence, New Line heavily butchered the film and cut out a lot of these great gore effects, which was an issue facing many horror films at this time.
The theatrical version of the movie made me look incompetent as a director. It was literally incoherent the way they had to cut it to cut around this stuff.
The recuts and reshoots got to be so expansive that director Jeff Burr demanded to have his name taken off the film, which never happened. The censored R-rated cut and the original unrated cut of Leatherface, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3 are both available on the same DVD, but I surely don't recommend rushing out there to buy it anytime soon. Austin, Texas-based attorney Robert J. Kuhn was an investor on the original film and was disliking the way the franchise was being handled. So in yet another attempt to jumpstart the franchise again, he brought in the first film's co-writer, Kim Henkel, to write and direct a modernized reimagining of the first movie.
We felt like we could kind of revive the film to bring it back to the spirit of the original. And I didn't really want to get involved as much as I wound up being involved, but finally let Bob Kuhn bully me into it.
This new Texas Chainsaw reboot has since become distinguished for mainly two reasons: Renee Zellweger and Matthew McConaughey. Two young Texas natives who were then unknown actors, but were mere inches away from hitting the big time. Zellweger played the lead girl Jenny, and McConaughey was cast as Vilmer Slaughter, Leatherface's demented brother. And to say that McConaughey was hamming it up would be a pretty hilarious understatement. Yeah, you're gonna get a lot of that in this one. Basically, you can tell director Kim Henkel was trying to, in a way, recreate Tobe Hooper's chaotic dinner scene. However, when the acting isn't completely atrocious, it's just plain obnoxious. Filmed in 1994 under the title The Return of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Columbia Pictures signed a deal to distribute it theatrically and on home video. However, the studio shelved it for 3 whole years.
They had decided not to release Chainsaw until after Jerry Maguire, and they thought it would help Chainsaw when it was released because Renee would be, you know, well known. They couldn't do the theatrical release because CAA said that they did not want Matthew McConaughey exploited in that film, and that they didn't believe in exploiting a known actor just to try to get a film released. And I said, well, I thought that's what you guys did for a living.
Not until 1997 did this movie finally see a limited theatrical run and subsequent home video release under the new title, Texas Chainsaw Massacre: The Next Generation, which certainly attempted to capitalize on Zellweger and McConaughey's newfound stardom. Honestly, there's really nothing more to say about Texas Chainsaw Massacre: The Next Generation, except for that it's an incoherent and horribly acted mess that may be worth a laugh or two just because it's so awful. Just by seeing the leads' faces take up the entire DVD cover makes it painfully clear that the only reason to watch this thing is for the novelty of seeing two famous actors in an extremely weird movie right before they became big names. A few years later, big-budget action director and splosionmeister Michael Bay, together with producers Brad Fuller and Andrew Form, established Platinum Dunes, a production company that set out to create lower-budgeted films with up-and-coming directors. Much to the dismay of classic horror fans everywhere, their first production was a full-fledged remake of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre that completely disregarded any of the previously established continuity. Released in 2003, the remake also took place in 1973 and featured another group of five young travelers, only this time they were heading to a Lynyrd Skynyrd concert while listening to Sweet Home Alabama. Of course they were, because as we all know, Sweet Home Alabama was the only song that existed in the South in the 70s. But wait a minute, Sweet Home Alabama didn't even come out until a year after this movie takes place. Fail. We're introduced to a brand new family of psychos, the Hewitts, led by the patriarch, Charlie Hewitt, played by the great R. Lee Ermey, who parades around in the uniform of a town sheriff he killed years ago, and his brother Thomas, the real name for this new, massive Leatherface, portrayed by hulking bodybuilder Andrew Brunarski. This new Leatherface wears his flesh masks to cover up a disfiguring skin condition and is really nothing but a one-note angry beast. With this being his feature film debut, German music video director Markus Nispel brought along with him his go-to cinematographer, who, by pure coincidence, just so happened to be Daniel Pearl, the cinematographer of the original film. Pearl obviously had zero intent on trying to recreate the look or the feel of the classic he originally photographed, so he deliberately gave this a much more slick and stylish look, which works for some and doesn't for others. But as much as I know I shouldn't be, I'm actually in the camp who enjoyed it for what it was, as a dark, grimy, and gory experience that may share some similar story beats with the first film, but still manages to craft its own moments of well-done tension. I just think that its biggest issue is that it's called The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and because of that, it'll always be compared to the original, and it will always lose. Also, it came out at a time where the idea of a horror remake wasn't nearly as overdone as it is nowadays, and unfortunately, I think this movie ended up being partly responsible for that, since its massive box office success was right on the cusp of this modern horror remake trend that we're still trudging through. Even the film's own production company, Platinum Dunes, has gone to practically brand itself as a factory of classic horror remakes, with some pretty poor results if you ask me. Now, whatever it was I liked about the 2003 remake all came crashing down 3 years later when Platinum Dunes decided to go backwards in the story with a prequel, Texas Chainsaw Massacre: The Beginning, which took place 4 years before the remake and brought back almost all of the major players from the Hewitt family, only slightly younger. The way I see it, for something to be scary or disturbing, one of the worst things a movie can do is explain too much. Once you know everything, the mystery is gone, and there's really nothing to be scared of anymore. I liked the family, for the most part, in the remake because just like in the original, most of the details about who they were or why they kill people were left up to your imagination. But now, Texas Chainsaw: The Beginning wants to reveal every single stinking detail, and this is what kills me about this film. Practically every single defining characteristic about the Hewitt family that was seen or merely alluded to in the first is explained to have happened all in the course of about a day. And that includes when Leatherface picks up his very first chainsaw and skins his first face. It was a completely stupid, pointless, and contrived prequel to a remake I actually thought was pretty decent. And I wasn't surprised at all when the film became a box office disappointment. The rebooted Texas Chainsaw continuity officially ended at Platinum Dunes, and several years later, producer Carl Mazzacone brought the rights to Lionsgate, the studio that had just finished a hugely successful 7-movie run with the highly popular Saw franchise in 2010. The studio's plan was to release a series of 6 new Texas Chainsaw films, granted if the first one was a success. January 2013 saw the release of Texas Chainsaw 3D, which essentially took every single sequel, reboot, and prequel and tossed them all out the window. this was going to be the first ever true sequel to the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The film's brilliant 10-minute prologue begins the day after the events of the first film, as the Sawyer family homestead is swarmed by police and a mob of angry gun-toting locals with the intent of burning down the house. Inside, Leatherface, who was still wearing the same dinner party getup from the night before, is now being scolded by the cook, Drayton Sawyer, for letting Sally Hardesty get away. And because of Jim Seedow's death in 2003, Drayton is portrayed here by Chop Top himself, Bill Moseley.
I like to say it's kind of like Moe coming back and playing Curly in a remake of The Three Stooges. So it's a little strange, but it's a lot of fun, and I'm really happy to have been handed the responsibility to do right by Jim.
In his first Texas Chainsaw film since being Leatherface in the original, Gunnar Hansen plays an extended family member, Boss Sawyer. And even John Dugan, who first played Grandpa when he was a teenager, came back to play the character once again all these years later.
It was 38 years ago, just walking up and seeing the house, and then seeing all the props and everything. The chicken, the live chicken. How long do chickens live? That's not the same chicken, is it?
Filmed in Louisiana, a full-scale replica of the original house had to be painstakingly recreated by the crew, and the attention to detail on the exterior, and especially the interior, were so impressive that the original cast members who visited the set were stunned at the authenticity.
And the stairs. Oh my goodness, they even did the wallpaper upstairs. That light blue with the little white flowers. They did some detail here. It is kind of like yesterday. I keep wanting to look behind my back and make sure somebody isn't chasing me here now.
Aside from Leatherface, the only other survivor of the hillbilly slaughter of the Sawyer family was a baby girl who was later adopted and grows up unaware of her evil family roots. We jump to present day, where the girl, Heather, played by Alexander Daddario, is now in her 20s, and... Wait, 20s? The movie takes place in present day, and the original is set in 1973. How the hell does that make any sense?
The main character's 25, she should be 35. I'm hoping nobody will hold us to accounts on that, but we wanted it to be a modern telling.
Clears that up.
After inheriting a lavish mansion from her biological grandmother, Heather and a group of friends travel across Texas to check it out, but will soon discover that Heather's cousin Leatherface has made a home for himself down in the wine cellar. Because of how well done the film's first 10 minutes were, I was sorely disappointed that it all unravels into a rather bland horror film. What kind of bugs me about it is that following the massacre of the Sawyer clan at the hands of the angry mob, we're now supposed to sympathize with Leatherface, and apparently forget about the sick and twisted acts of savagery he and his family carried out in the first film. Having classic movie monsters evolve into crowd-pleasing anti-heroes is surely nothing new, but in this case, I'm just not buying it. While I did enjoy all the little nods to the original film, the returning cast members, the filmmaker's visible love for the mythology, and the impressive makeup effects, I just thought it all amounted to a painfully dull slasher flick, and its mediocrity is even more visible by trying to be a direct sequel to such a revolutionary picture. I don't think it necessarily deserves the hate I've seen thrown at it, but it was just too lukewarm to be an interesting six-movie franchise starter. While I can't say I enthusiastically recommend checking out Texas Chainsaw 3D, I will say that its well-crafted prologue is certainly worth a look on its own. So where does that leave us? Well, Lionsgate isn't apparently rushing to do a sequel to Texas Chainsaw 3D. However, as of the production of this video, talks of another prequel are in the works that will dig into Leatherface's teenage years. Not again. As we've just seen, this strange franchise has been through the ringer so many times that it really makes no difference at this point how many more movies keep getting added to the pile. And no matter how many sequels, prequels, squeakquels, reboots, or remakes have been made or will get made, absolutely nothing will ever surpass the classic, the frightening, the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Thanks for joining me today on this extensive dissection of one of the most influential and important horror films ever concocted. For more movie reviews, check out happydragonpictures.com, like the official Happy Dragon Pictures Facebook page, and follow me on Twitter at @happydragondave for all the latest updates. So I'll see you next time, but for now, this one's going back on the DVD shelf.
Got to tell the secret of that fabulously tasty chili.
No secret.
It's the meat. Don't skimp on the meat. I got a real good eye for prime meat. Runs in the family. Whoop, whoop. It's one of those hard-shelled peppercorns.